deliverer. And when he delivers completely. Not halfway, not partly. He delivers completely. And that's why we say, oh, how great you Abanilagbato. He delivers me completely, yes. There is nothing too hard for him to deliver me from. He sets me free. His Savior, he can move the mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and he conquered the grave. Jesus conquered. Savior, he can move the mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever. Hope of salvation. He rose. Jesus comes on. One more time. Savior, Savior. He can move the mountain. My God. Money to save. Forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered. Jesus conquered. Savior, Savior, Savior.
He can move the mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever. Author of salvation.
He rose. Jesus, hallelujah. We're here because he conquered the grave. The Bible says we love him because he first loved us. Can we just express from our hearts how much we love him this morning? Father, we're here this morning to celebrate you, to express our love for you. We declare our everlasting love for you. Lord, we want to say to you this morning, we love you. We love you. We bless you from the depths of our heart. We worship you, mighty God. We celebrate you for your goodness, for your kindness, for your love. That even when we're under the clutches of death and hell, when we were lost in sin, you came and died for us. We thank you for your fatherhood. I don't know what your experience might be today. Whether you have been hurt, whether you have been disappointed, whether you have been betrayed. But I want to say to you this morning, there is someone that loves you more than anybody could ever love you. There is somebody that believes in you despite all that might have happened to you. There's someone that will continue to say to you that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. He is Jehovah, and we're here because of him. Lord, we bless you. Sing a song to God in the spirit this morning. Bless him from the depths of your heart. He alone deserves our worship. He alone deserves our praise. He alone deserves our adoration. Lord, we bless you this morning. from the depths of our hearts, from the depths of our heart, from the depths of our soul, from the depths of our spirit, we say we love you. We love you. We love you. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah. I love you, Lord.
And I lift my voice
to worship.
To worship you, oh my soul.
Rejoice.
Sweet
sounds
in your ear,
in your ear.
Oh, I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. And I lift my voice to
privilege of acceptable worship.
I will love you.
We bow our hearts before you this morning.
I will love you, Jesus.
I will give you the praise that only you deserve in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Still in an attitude of worship, I want us to lift up Nigeria this morning and pray for this country. Bible says concerning us that we are the light of the world. A city that is set upon a hill cannot be hid. And he said that that light shines in darkness, and darkness is not able to comprehend it. This morning, I want you to pray and speak over Nigeria that the light of a church will shine in darkness, in the darkness that is trying to envelop this nation, and darkness will not be able to comprehend it. We speak light to every sector. We speak light to every office. We speak light to every ministry. We speak light into the corridors of power in the mighty name of Jesus. And as you pray, I want you to begin to speak to God and ask God for courage to shine your light wherever you function. You function in an office, you function in a ministry, you function in an organization, in a corporation. Ask God for grace and capacity this week to shine your light. Let your light so shine before men. The Bible says that men may see your good works and glorify the Father that is in heaven. Nigeria is made up of people like yourself and myself. If we all determine to shine our lights, this country will be different. Lord, I receive the grace, the courage, the strength to shine my light this week, that through me men will glorify your name, that through me good works will be wrought this week in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, every opportunity to shine your light, I will not shy away from in the name of Jesus. Where I've fallen before, I choose to stand this week in the name of Jesus. I will not compromise where I've compromised in the past. I determine in my heart this week that I will shine your light, that you will use me, that you will use me to move this nation forward. I don't know which sector you represent. I don't know which industry in which you function. I don't know what it is exactly that you do, but God wants to shine through you this week. God wants to begin to accelerate change through you this week. Receive the grace and the courage in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. We give you praise. We celebrate your presence. We know you're here already and you have determined to bless us. We ask that you have your way in our midst this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. We're excited to be in the house this morning. Let's jam our hands together and celebrate God. He is faithful. He is worthy of our praise and our worship. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Please look at your neighbor and give them a very warm hug, a very warm handshake, and just spread the love. Spread the love. Spread the love anointing this morning. Hallelujah. You may have your seat in his presence. I'd like you to also help me appreciate the internet audience, the people who are logged on to this service from all over the world. God bless you. Thank you for being a part of this service. We trust that the same grace that we're enjoying in this service is available to you wherever you are in the mighty name of Jesus. As we proceed in the service this morning, we have two testimonies. We want to take two testimonies quickly. Please help me celebrate Tina Uchendu and Chioma Enwere as they come forward to give their testimonies. Tina Uchendu and Chioma Enwere, please come forward. Help me celebrate them, please, as they come forward.
Hello, church. Good morning. It's enraging. The J was somewhere under. Well, I've got a very good testimony. Today is my birthday, so I'm so thankful to God for that. And I also want to say a big thank you to the brother who just led the worship service. I was in church on Wednesday and I heard the song for the first time, You Are the Reason, and I asked him to please include that in the worship today, and he did. So thank you so much. That was a wonderful birthday gift to me. Today is my fourth service in church this year, and let's not talk about last year. Last year was about 3 or 4, thereabout. And I'm so thankful to God for this church. I'm thankful to God for my cluster group, the Agungi Lekki cluster group. They've just been so amazing. When I came to church, it's not like I was a lost soul really, but I just came to church because I wanted to come to church. But somehow, my group members and my leader, Brother Victor, they've been able to, you know, make church and make being a Christian more fulfilling and more promising for me. And I'm also thankful to Pastor Goodman for this Love Clinic series that we're on. Last 2 weeks, Wednesday, I think we played a tape on Pastor Joyce Meyer, where she talked about her life and how she had been abused and all of that. And after the tape, Pastor Goodman encouraged us to talk about it more, and that way it was going to be easier for us to let go and easier to, you know, grow in the faith, grow in the love of Christ. And I decided to try that experiment in my cluster group last Sunday. And even though I made a mess, you know, with my face and all of that, but I thank God that I'm able to, I feel like I've actually let go of the hurt a little bit, and I made some calls to, you know, like the people who caused it. Okay. Thank you all so much. I can't continue.
Hallelujah. He's Pastor Godman, but he's a good man.
Good morning, church. My name is Tina. I want to thank God for a new job. This particular job, I wrote the entry test like 6 times. I failed. So the 7th time, I wasn't really encouraged. So I went anyway. I'm used to failing it, so I just went. And I wrote, I was surprised. They called me and said I passed. Trust me, the other 6 times, I read. But this time, I didn't read because I didn't bother. So when they said I passed, I said it probably would be God, or the person that I was marking was sleeping. Because I didn't know what I wrote, I'll be honest. I didn't know what I wrote. I was just gambling with the whole thing. And one of the interviews, I was ill. So I came into the office of the person who was supposed to interview me. So the man saw me shaking because of the AC. He said, I should sit down. I shouldn't worry. And he said, the other things he was going to ask me were just procedure. But I shouldn't worry that he has already passed me. So that he will prepare me for the next person I would meet, that she's a lady and she's tough. So he put me through a lot of things I didn't know. And it was like revision. He was just teaching me. I didn't know this man from Adam, nowhere. And the next one was a walkover, actually, because he already gave me some tips on what to say. So at the end, I got the job. So I want to thank God. It was just me. Thank you.
Hallelujah. That is what happens when favor shows up. Bible says the Lord will bless the righteous and with favor will encompass him as a shield. I want to just thank God for that testimony. Let's celebrate God again for those testimonies. Father, we thank you for the healing and for the favor that we're enjoying in the house. To take us further in the service this morning, I'd like you to give a very strong God bless you to the Elevation Priest of Praise as they bless us.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. As our God being good.
Yes, he has.
Come on, as our God being good.
Yes, he has.
It didn't even have to die, but it chose to die for us. What love. Come on, if you know that God has been good to you in this place, you can do better than that. You can do better than that. You can do better than that. He loves you more than your husband. He loves you more than your wife. He loves you more than your father. He loves you more than your mother. Oh yes, he is good. And his mercy endureth forever. It's been his grace. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory to God. Our God is good. And his grace has been keeping us. We're standing here today because of his grace. I don't know about you. I've not always been good in my life, but no, God has been faithful. And it's been his grace. You know, maybe you're like me, you're not that chubby, but you still love me. And he loves you too. Come on, look at your neighbor and tell that person, God loves me. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, that person, it's because of his grace I'm here this morning. We just want to testify to his grace this morning. Hallelujah. Oh, 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 Lord, your grace. Oh, Lord, your grace. And the song says, Lord, your grace, covering me like the salt summer shower. That's right. Raining down on me. Goodness and mercy. Loving me daily. Forgiving me freely. I need the choir to get excited this morning and help me say, Lord, your grace.
Lord, your grace.
Say, covering me like the sun. Say, raining down on me. Goodness and mercy, loving me daily, forgiving me freely. Say, poor and afraid, left out, lost and alone, till your tender love came and make me your own. How can I make it, and where would I be without your undeserved favor? Your grace,
Lord,
to cover me like the sun.
It's
raining down on goodness and mercy, loving me daily, forgiving me freely. Say, wisdom abound, gifts abound, so much more. Covering me from the sun to the floor. Cause the truth is,
I know that I
am complete. When I look back over all these years that I made it true, can imagine where I'd be now if it wasn't for you. While your favor rests upon me, I can never. Hey, go so glad I can say your grace in my life lasts forever. Your grace I see every morning. Grace that I see every morning. Yeah, yeah. Say, your grace in my life lasts forever. Your goodness and mercy I see every day. Somebody come on. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Sing it. I'll sing your praise every day, every morning. Hey, when I wake up, when I sleep at night. I'm singing your praise every day of my life, Lord. So glad. Oh, I know. Yes, Lord. I can imagine. Oh, where I've been now. See, all the favor rests upon me, I can never explain. But I'm so glad that I can say it.
Come on. I need you to put your hands together like this. Everybody, come on. Come on. If you know that the Lord has shown you grace, put your hands together.
Yeah, just make sure you smile at somebody. And if you don't smile, I'm not going to preach. Because I'm seeing some people are not smiling. Smile. Praise God. How was Valentine's Day? Somebody say, Pastor, don't go there. Okay, I'm not going to go there. Yeah, you see, some people say exactly. Let's not go there. But I hope you got, if you're on our mailing list, you have gotten a Valentine's card. Yeah, on Valentine's Day. Did you love that? Yeah, so even if you didn't receive a card from anybody, you got from your church. Praise God. And we did something else. I sent, you know, almost all the single ladies in this church. I said almost because I know some people may not be on our database. But all the single ladies we had on our database, you all got a personalized text message from me on Valentine's Day. Yes. I made sure that the name of everybody was written. Every person that got that text was personalized, was deliberate. Because I just wanted to know that the love of God is flowing in this house. And that even if you didn't get a gift and nobody, you know, bothered to say Happy Valentine, your pastor is saying it. Yes. And I'm saying it on behalf of God with no ulterior motive. And so you must receive it and internalize it and know that God cannot forget you. Say amen, somebody. Amen. Yeah, God cannot forget you. Because this season is a season of love and, you know, celebration of love and all that. But we're all at different phases in life. And for some people, it reminds you of some other things. And that's the time to just put your mind on God instead of allowing the devil to, you know, make you focus on what can sink your emotion or make you depressed. Praise God. I said, praise God. All right, so how was Valentine? Oh, how is Valentine now that I've spoken? Valentine is good, right? All right. Praise God. I want you to join me in your Bibles in Romans chapter 13. Romans chapter 13, because I heard somebody saying, Pastor, get into the word. Leave Valentine alone. Yes, Romans 13. I continue with the Love Clinic this morning, a series that we started a few weeks ago at the beginning of the month. And we thank God for all the healings and all the testimonies coming from this series. Believe that God will perfect what he has started in Jesus' name. Romans 13, I'm sharing on what I've titled, Daring Greatly, the courage to love and be loved.
daring greatly, the courage to love and be loved. In Romans 13, I read from verse 8 to 10. It says, owe no one anything except to love one another. For he who loves another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not covet. And if there's any other commandment, all are summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. The Lord bless the reading of his word. The Bible says here that love is the fulfillment of the law. We have approached love this season from the point of view of healing, from the point of view of, you know, definite connections, from the point of view of wholeness, and also from the point of view of a way of life. Last Sunday I was talking about loving the unlovable. It's a way of life that God wants us to embrace because we have seemingly unlovable people all around us. And there's nothing we can do about them. The truth is, you can't change anyone. It takes God to change anyone. So, how do we keep loving as a way of life? Knowing that God is counting on us to demonstrate his love. The Bible says God is love, and whosoever loves is of God. And this scripture here says, owe no man nothing. Don't owe any man anything except for love. That you love them, you show them love, you give and you receive love. In fact, the truth is that, you know, from my studies of many years, I've realized that life only becomes interesting. Life only becomes something to look forward to when you can say that love is flowing from you and love is flowing to you. In fact, when it's one way or one-sided, it creates tension in life. Love, you know, must be flowing from you and flowing to you. That's what makes life interesting. That's what makes life fulfilling. It's under that kind of atmosphere that we can fulfill destiny. Many of us, like we said 2 weeks ago, we cannot function. Remember the message, when love hurts. You cannot function when love is not flowing to you. Especially the way it's supposed to be flowing. Why do we have agitations in marriage and, you know, what's a dysfunctional marriage? A dysfunctional marriage is the one in which love is probably only flowing in one direction and it's not flowing in the opposite direction, or it's not flowing at all. The marriage becomes dysfunctional. If one person is the only one showing love, marriage is dysfunctional. If no love is not flowing from either party, they're just flatmates. They're no longer married. And then the marriage becomes highly disposable, like I taught last September. If you weren't here, I wanted to get Mr. and Mrs. Better Half Season 2. Marriage becomes disposable, just like tissue paper. You use and throw away. When love, which is the essence for intimacy, for every other thing that we enjoy in marriage, when it's flowing, you know, back and forth. And it takes courage to keep loving. It takes courage to keep receiving love. And that's what we're discussing this morning. Daring greatly, the courage to love and be loved. If you have never engaged courage for anything in your life, it's time to engage courage to love. At least it will give you peace of mind for every other thing you want to do in life. Some of us need courage to start a new enterprise. Some need courage to take up a new position. A lady walked up to me after the last service and said, Pastor, You just spoke about courage to love. Me, as I speak now, see, my husband is here. We're loving each other. But I need courage for the position I'm resuming tomorrow morning. It's a marketing director position. What I applied for was manager. They gave me director. I didn't know how to handle it. And I held a hand, received courage. I prayed with her. And I said, see, all of us in this church, we're behind you. Add all of our courage together and go and resume. I said, when you get there, if there's trouble, call me. You know, sometimes you have to pump people. And it's the same thing. When someone, instead of getting love back, you have loved. But people have crushed your heart over and again. You get to a point where you just resign and tell yourself, I'm not loving again. And you see, when people resign from loving again, what happens? They themselves start to struggle to love other people. Yeah. Love becomes a struggle when you, especially, have made up your mind that you are going to refuse love flowing to you. Then you yourself become a struggler in giving out love. Because it's supposed to be flowing freely for you, from you, and to you. That's what makes life interesting. But it takes a lot of courage. I got this piece out of Teddy Roosevelt speech titled The Man in the Arena, a speech he gave April 23rd, 1910 in Paris, France. That was a period where there was a need for a lot of motivation, you know, around the world because of all the different things happening then. This particular speech has made the round, you know, around the world. When you, if you just, you know, maybe Google The Man in the Arena or something like that, you'll see all sorts. There's an almanac on Facebook with this on it, you know, with thousands of likes and different things. And I feel this way, this, what I'm talking about when it talks to, you know, when it comes to real courage. It says, it's not the critic who counts. Not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of the deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again because there is no effort without error and shortcomings, but who does actually strive to do the deeds? Who knows great enthusiasm, the great devotion? Who spends himself in a worthy cause? Who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement? And who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly. So that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. When you resign to fate when it comes to loving, when you refuse to embrace and cultivate the courage to love, you belong to the last category that he mentioned there. Those cold and timid souls who never know victory nor defeat. That will not be your portion. In the precious name of Jesus. So it takes a lot of courage to love. Especially the God kind of love. And when you read through the Bible, especially in the Old Testament, I want to pick out a character this morning that I want us to just look through. It's a man that even God himself said, this is a man after my own heart. His name is David. David demonstrated the courage that made God look at him and said, the throne or the kingdom of David shall be an everlasting kingdom. By implication, from this lineage, this is where I will always look for royalty. Why? Because of what a man did. One man. And amongst many things that you can claim that David did, I just want to pick out this one in line with this discussion this morning, which is that courage to love even in the face of danger. David chose the love of God to flow through him and flow, you know, from him. I mean, flow to him and flow from him to other people. And we can see it, you know, from just looking at a particular point in his life and how he aligned himself with God's purpose for that time, walking in love. And I'm talking about no other time in his life but the time that he was kept in waiting. You know what happened to David? They gave him a letter of appointment as CEO. But they told him, shh, this appointment takes effect when the current CEO dies. And you know what? Because of love, you are not permitted to kill him. That was what happened to David. David had no hand in Saul's dealings with God. Saul was sacked by God. David was not in the picture. So it wasn't David's fault that Saul was sacked. Saul walked his way out of God's heart by simple disobedience. Simple disobedience. I'm going to read that account from 1 Samuel chapter 15, and verse 22 to 23. Saul had been given a charge by God to go to Amalek and destroy the place. You can read further if you're asking the question, why did God decide to destroy Amalek? Go and read 1 Samuel. But God wanted to destroy Amalek and sent Saul, the king of Israel, Saul, God to Amalek. Destroyed everything but left the king, Agag. And then looked around, and in modern day terminologies, if you say, Saul kind of looked around, saw the official cars in Amalek, Lexus, Jeep, and Co. And just said, boys, all these ones, take them to my garage. And I looked at the balance sheet of Amalek and saw their investments in the stock market. All the ones that are doing very well, packed all of them and took them. You know, bring all the papers, you know, transfer to this place. And right from where Samuel, the prophet of God, was sitting, he started to, in the spirit, had the bleating of sheep. And God said, that's Saul. He's a disobedient child. Go to him now and tell him to his face that I've rejected him. And this was what happened here. Samuel got to where Saul was. And this was what Samuel said. So Samuel said, verse 22 of 1 Samuel 15, as the Lord has great delight in burnt offering and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king. So on that particular, at that particular moment, on that particular occasion, Saul was sacked from being king over Israel, God's people. And if we read the last verse of 1 Samuel 15, God had to tell Samuel, the account was there that Samuel never appeared before Saul again until Saul passed on. Never showed up in front of Saul again. And in verse, I think in chapter 16, the earlier verses there, God spoke to Samuel. Why are you still mourning over Saul? Forget about Saul. Saul's era is over. It's like, you know, let's move on. Go to the house of Jesse and anoint me a king there. And that was how David showed up in this story. David showed up in this manner. Saul went to the house of Jesse, the father of David. David was a boy of no significance, no stature, no nothing comely about David, truly. Because he got to the house of his father and they could not even remember that he was a son in the house. There were bigger boys in the house. David's brothers, Eliab, all those boys with big biceps and all that. You know, fine boys. Saul got to the house of David's father And he said, bring out your sons. And he paraded all his sons. And Saul saw one of them. And said, this is the Lord's. Samuel saw one of them. And said, this is the Lord's anointed. And God had to speak to him. Prophet, are you smoking something? It looks like you're not hearing me. This is not my anointed. If Samuel had to ask, oh, do you have any other boy? Then he now remembered. Yeah. Oh, there was one boy like that. It's the backside of the desert, you know. And the man said, we will not sit until you have brought this boy today. So David did not start out in his father's house like Joseph, who had coat of many colors and, you know, preferential treatment and all that. No. While boys were like Jesse at home, he was at the backside of the desert. And his father did not even remember that he was there. And that was the person God has chosen. But it became more tricky when David came. Samuel anointed him as king, but his kingship will not take effect, even though he had been anointed. So he became the man in waiting. And when you are in waiting, a lot of the time, you don't have the time to show love. You want to just move. I hope you understand what I'm saying. It's like when a sister has started to see that, you know, or when a brother has received a sister, like we say in the kingdom, has received. But you can't talk yet. And you are now seeing other people around the sister. You feel like throwing a stone at them to say, leave them. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. Sometimes it's sisters. You like a guy, but you know that it's not appropriate for you to say that you like the brother. So you are praying in your closet, and God is assuring you that don't worry. Whatever I've ordained for you, you will get there. If this is my will for you, you will get this brother. So you see the brother after the service and the sister, they are walking to the car park together, and you are looking. Where are you from? That's what you're saying. Who are you? I will pray for you when I get home. You better leave that place. See, that's the kind of situation that David was into. And you know what happened? Because God rejected Saul. Saul started to misbehave. In fact, you know how you know that God is far away from you? You start to make stupid mistakes. In fact, if anyone is under the influence of this service today and you are making seriously stupid mistakes, you need to go back to your prayer closet and ask yourself, God, what is happening? Saul started to, in fact, what happened? The moment David was anointed and vacancy was declared upon the throne of Israel, Saul started to misbehave. Evil spirits started to worry his life. And then the only person that was found who can play on the harp to help him to soothe this affliction was David. So David was called to the palace, and David would play on the harp, and Saul would feel better. The spirit would leave him temporarily. And as if that wasn't good enough, then Saul went to battle and was supposed to to stand as king at the Valley of Elah against this giant called Goliath. But don't forget, God had rejected Saul. So he lacked the courage and the grace to face Goliath. And when a king abdicates his responsibility, the throne is truly vacant. What didn't occur to Saul was that whoever brought down Goliath is actually the real king of Israel. But he didn't have the anointing again. Because when the anointing is upon a man, what you will say is that I would rather die in battle as a king than be on the throne and somebody is taking my place. So this small boy, with the anointing of God on his life, brought down Goliath. And you know that women, they love to sing praises of winners. Winner, oh, winner, winner, oh, winner. David, you don't win, oh. So women started to sing. Saul has killed his thousands. David is 10,000. They arrogated Goliath to be a 10,000 worth of men. That was what David brought down. And Saul became crazier, even at the sound of that. David was in his chamber once. Saul took up a javelin at close range. I studied very carefully to understand the king's chamber is not a seriously big space. Maybe like two or three times your normal sitting room. So it was at close range. It took providential help for David not to be killed that day. Threw the javelin at him. David was able to dodge it. And from that day, David knew there was trouble. Is there someone here you felt that before? Somebody spoke one word to you and it was like a javelin. Came straight into your heart. Somebody who is supposed to or give a good recommendation of you said something completely different. Someone told you that in this place, both of us cannot be here together. Is that somebody will leave or somebody will stay? Like I said last Sunday, some of the offices that some of us work, they're worse than PDP. The kind of politics that go on there. Yeah. I reckon with that. I recognize that. Some of the offices that some of us work, some of the people that you work with there, they're supposed to be APC members. They're not supposed to be working in any office. They're supposed to be politicians. Because they are full-time politicians. They do their real work part-time. No, that's the truth. That's the way some people work. You hire an accountant. Instead of the person to do the work, the accounting work itself is done part-time. But politicking is a full-time job. They talk all the time, moving from one place to the other, and you know whatever things that shouldn't even concern them. They're interested. They want to know who is coming there, who is going there. And as far as they're concerned, life is like a chessboard. You know, just move people, do and undo. And when you work with such people, before you know it, seeds are planted in your heart to be like them. With all that David encountered in the hand of Saul, God tried David. And David was not found wanting, especially as far as love is concerned. David loved greatly. He demonstrated the courage to love even when it was not convenient. Even when it was not convenient, he demonstrated the courage to love. David was very vulnerable. Vulnerable. He allowed himself to be vulnerable. You know what it means for David to be coming into a covenant with Jonathan? Jonathan being the son of Saul. How can you cut a covenant with the son of your enemy? How can you be that vulnerable to say, this is where I want to receive love from? You know, some of us, the way we grew up, especially if you're like me, you grew up in a polygamous home, and your stepmother is the enemy of your mother. And your mother will tell you, if I see you with our children, see this cane, I will finish it on your life. So from growing up, you know, you know that the children of the enemy of my mother, they're my enemy. And we have, you know, walls that separate us. Lines that people must not cross. Some of us grew up that way. And there's a lot of bitterness and animosity and strife. And then we carry it from home if we are not healed. And if we don't have encounters with Jesus, carry it like that into the workplace. Carry it like that even into our own nuclear family that we're setting up. I tell you the truth, if you don't push what you have experienced in the past behind, they can follow you even into just husband-wife relationship. Yeah. We begin to see ourselves. A woman says, I'm Asena. The man says, I'm Manu. In the same house. I'm saying, that's the kind of attitude that we put up sometimes. As if we're playing for different clubs. And we're married. And we're supposed to be one team. And sometimes because of where we're coming from, we bring it back into our own family. We'll bring it back. We'll bring it to the office. We'll bring it everywhere. So it becomes very difficult to really walk in love. David's encounter with Saul created a very serious atmosphere for grief, for animosity, for him not never to be vulnerable. but demonstrated the courage to engage peace in the midst of turmoil, to engage, you know, kindness, even when the man was showing cruelty. The grace to remain on the path of truth, the courage to forgive, and the courage to live in obedience. These were all the courage that David demonstrated. Let me show you how he demonstrated some of this courage. In 1 Samuel 24, David had the first opportunity to kill Saul. Saul was all over, wanting to as if Saul got information that Samuel actually anointed David. Saul wanted to just kill him, take him out. And just because he was stealing the show by killing Goliath. Look at this encounter in 1 Samuel 24. The first time that David was spared the life of Saul. Now it happened when, 1 Samuel 24 verse 1. Now it happened when Saul had returned from following the Philistines, that he was told, saying, "Take note, David is in the wilderness of En-Gedi." Then Saul took 3,000 men, just to go and kill one man. He mobilized all his influence together. 3,000 men from all Israel, and went to seek David and all his men in the rocks of the wild goats. So he came to the sheepfold by the road where there was a cave, and Saul went in to attend to his needs. Saul actually went to the cave to ease himself. David and his men were staying in the recess of the cave. They were in the recess of the cave. Look at what happened. Then the men of David said to him, "This is the day of which the Lord said to you, 'Behold, I will deliver your enemy into your hand, that you may do to him as it seems good to you.'" Look at what happened here. And David arose and secretly cut off a corner of Saul's robe. Now it happened afterward that David's heart troubled him because he had cut Saul's robe. I mean, look at that. That's the kind of heart that I want. Tap your neighbor, say, "You need that kind of heart." David and his men were in the cave. Saul strayed into the cave to ease himself. Saul must have, you know, with all his rope, doing the needful. You understand what I'm saying? And David and his men were in the recess part of the cave, and they saw him. And the boy said, "Ha, bros, this is the day that the Lord has made. We should do and undo. Just strike him." And David went closer, you know, the king's rope, and just cut the hedge. Just cutting the hedge. The Bible says his heart troubled him. He must have heard that small hedge and, you know, almost in tears. "What have I done?" Are you the kind of person that will speak evil about people and your heart will not even prick you at all? You talk people down, slice them to bits with your mouth, and your heart does not even touch you at all. David only cut just the hem of his garment, and his heart was too troubled. His heart was troubled. Look at what he said to the boys there. And he said to his men, "The Lord forbid that I should do this thing to my master, the Lord's anointed, to stretch out my hand against him, seeing he is the anointed of the Lord." So David restrained his servant with these words and did not allow them to rise against Saul. And Saul got up from the cave and went his way. It was afterwards that David came out of the cave too and called Saul. And Saul looked at David and noticed that he had the opportunity to kill him and he didn't kill him. He was saying, "You are more righteous than I am." But that didn't take the evil spirit away. He still went after him after that. But where am I going? Can we all trust God for that kind of heart? The heart that can be troubled when we are walking out of love. I hope you understand what I'm saying. A heart that can be troubled when I'm breaking the boundary of love walk. When I'm stepping into gossip, I'm backbiting. When I'm beginning to paint my spouse bad, can my heart trouble me? When I have the opportunity to take my boss's job, and I can just say one or two things to turn the situation around and I'll get the job, can I be restrained from talking? That's the kind of heart that David demonstrated here. Tap another neighbor and tell them, I need that kind of heart. Praise God. I said, praise God. Now, let's take this a little further and then I'll start to round off. 1 Samuel 26. The second demonstration of the courage to love. The second encounter that David had, upon which he would have destroyed his enemy by himself. But it took courage, a lot of courage, for him to be restrained. In 1 Samuel 26, when you read from verse 5 to 11, let's read the story. So David arose and came to the place where Saul had encamped. And David saw the place where Saul lay. And Abner, the son of Ner, the commander of his army, that's Saul's army, and Saul lay within the camp with the people encamped around him. Then David answered and said to Ahimelech the Hittite and Abishai the son of Zeruiah, brother of Joab, saying, who will go down with me to Saul in the camp? And look at that. One guy volunteered. Abishai said, I will go down with you. So David and Abishai came to the people by night. And there Saul lay sleeping within the camp with his spear stuck in the ground by his head. And Abner and the people all lay around him. They were all sleeping. God made the spirit of slumber to descend upon them. It was a second opportunity for David to prove himself before God. Don't forget, these were all tests that God took David through. It looked like an opportunity, but it was a test. A lot of the time, opportunities to misbehave present themselves, but they are actually a test from God. A test from God. So look at what ensued here. So David and Abishai came to the people by night, and there Saul lay sleeping within the camp with his spear stuck in the ground by his head, and Abner and all the people around him, they were all sleeping. Then Abishai said to David, God has delivered your enemy into your hand this day. Now therefore, please, let me strike him at once with the spear, right to the heart. I will not have to strike him a second time. Abishai said, you know what? You're a good man. But you know what? Move. Just give me permission. I will do for you a neat job. Neat. You know, that's what some people will say. Don't worry, it's a neat job. Nobody will trace it to you, anything. Let me just do it. Let's take this guy out. It's a neat job. I will strike him only once. I promise you, just once. And that's the end of it. And the next thing is, you'll be king. Said, this is the day that God has delivered your enemy into your hand. How many of us want our enemies to be delivered into our hands? Now you are not talking. If I ask this question before now, everybody would have said yes. It's a dangerous thing for God to deliver your enemy into your hand. It's a test. Remember last Sunday I was reading, God said, vengeance is mine and I will repay. I said, that's God's assignment. Focus on your assignment. But I said, for you, if your enemy is hungry, give him food. If he starts to give him water. But for me, that's my job. I am called the judge of the universe. So vengeance is mine. I am the one that repay. You face your assignment. And that's what you see here. Look at what David said. David understood that concept, that vengeance is God's. And that if you want to live in peace and you want to meet your God and be at peace with him, love all men. Show them some love. There are people listening to me here this morning, that people God will put in your heart. Send them a gift, even though they've hurt you badly. The gift, I mean, just do it dispassionately. Just obey the word of God. It takes courage to walk with God. It takes courage to be a man after God's heart. It takes courage to imbibe the nature of God, which is love. It takes a lot of courage. It's not easy, but it is doable. David demonstrated it. But David said to Abishai, "Do not destroy him. For who can stretch out his hand against the Lord's anointed and be guiltless?" Now, somebody can be saying here, David did all this because Saul happened to be the anointed. It's like saying, don't talk bad about your pastor, but Edosha cut him down. I mean, is that not what people say sometimes? Because David was saying that nobody can touch the Lord's anointed, you know, and all that. For your information, Saul was ex-anointed as at that time. God rejected him a long time ago. But David still has regard for Saul in his heart. By implication, the love of God is to flow from us to all men, regardless of stature, regardless of position or anything. Every human being is an extension of God because we all derive from God. Are you still with me? I said, are you still with me? So David says, no one can stretch out his hand against the Lord's anointed and be guiltless. David said, furthermore, as the Lord lives, the Lord shall strike him, or his day shall come to die, or he shall go out to battle and perish. David said, as far as I'm concerned, I'm not going to touch him. He has three options. God himself can kill him, or he will just naturally, when his day has come, die. Or he goes to battle and they strike him down. And the last one was what happened. Yeah. On his own, he went to battle. They struck him. He was wounded. Then one Amalekite came and he said, just finish me, kill me. And the young man killed Saul, took his crown of the, you know, all the paraphernalia of office that showed that he was the king, took everything and went to David. Was a stupid man. He didn't know he was dealing with. So in 2 Samuel chapter 1, this guy went to David and said, now the Lord has finished your enemy. He can then become king. And said, what do you mean? He said, Saul died today. He said, what happened to him? He said, I met him. And he said, I should kill him. And I killed him. Ah! David said, you did the wrong thing. With your mouth, you have committed yourself today. He said, cut his head. Even at Saul's death, David still honored him. And the person who killed Saul, David still killed him. Ha. For some of us, you buy that guy a Jeep for fast-tracking the will of God. Am I saying the truth? Yes, I am. You killed him. Ah. Correct guy. Come. Take cabinet position. Yeah. I can trust you. But it's a lie. David took the guy out. Said, anyone that will try to help God in this situation cannot be my friend. The big question today is, can you truly say that there's courage in my heart to love and to receive love? I can go on and on and on. David had the opportunity to receive love from Jonathan. He received it, despite the fact that Jonathan happened to be Saul's son. We can read another part of the scripture where David had this encounter with Abigail and Nabal. Nabal being a very stupid man. The Bible says that Nabal was sharing something they call sharing. The ship. And usually you call many people to come in. It's like you throw a party because you have to feed everyone who comes to work for you. And David had been meeting his men while they were rearing his animal. And they would be attacked and David people would defend them. And then David told his guys, they were hungry that day, why not go and meet Nabal? Now that he has a party, maybe he can give us something to eat and package some stuff for us. So the guys went and met Nabal. The Bible says Nabal was a foolish man. Nabal looked at them and said, ah. You know, in my language, they say, you will see. That this is beneath me. How can this fugitive, this boy? He said, there are many guys, young men these days, who won't stay in their master's house. They just move around like evil spirits. See this one, sending. He told them off. Told them to get out. Those guys went to meet David. David was nursing rejection. For a man, unprotected man, to reject him again. David told the guys, get your arms in place. Let's go. We'll strike him. So I said, David was not really a perfect man. He was on his way. But one of their servants told Abigail, the wife of Nabal, the way the master spoke to David's boys, what will come out of it will not be good. Because those guys have been good to us. It was our opportunity to bless them back, but master was being stupid. His wife ran and met them on the road. For the first time in a long time, David saw love. This woman got down, praised him, called him my Lord. Said, don't worry yourself about the man. Said, have you not heard his name? Nabal. Nabal means foolishness. He said, he just acted out his name. Don't take it out on him. He was just acting out his natural self. But we recognize you as a man after God's heart. Take. Let you and your men, you know, just eat and everything. To say that David has the heart to receive love, even in the face of rejection. And he won't say, no. I gave him one chance. He said, one chance. He blew that one chance. I deal with him. David took everything from Abigail and they left. A few days later, Nabal had heart attack and died. Read it. He didn't say heart attack, but it looked like it. Truly. Because what happened to him was heart attack. He had a heart attack and died. And then the next thing David said was that, that woman that knows how to show love, go and get her. I need somebody like that around me. I need love to be flowing to me. Let her be doing it every day. Yeah, my head will be calm and correct. Because the woman was able to make him not to misbehave. This one time that the blood of a man would have been on his head. The woman averted it. And it was because he was open and vulnerable enough to listen to the woman. Not to trample over her. To receive love from her. In closing, how do we cultivate the courage to love? I'll go through a list. We have cut this list out in papers. Hospitality unit, do we still have those stuff to be distributed? All right. As you are going out, you pick one. This is my prayer. That the one you pick will truly be the one that God wants you to work on. And I want everybody to leave with that one paper, read it, and go and pray about it, you know, the remaining part of this weekend and all through this week. That God will help you to be able to cultivate, you know, the courage to love and be loved. The first thing is to cultivate authenticity. Let go of what people think. Cultivate authenticity. Be authentic in yourself. If it was about what people thought, David should have killed Saul a long time. All the people around him said, God has delivered him to your hand. They told him, do as occasion have you. But his love for God and for man was authentic. Even in the face of temptation, he was able to stand his ground. So it's time to cultivate authenticity, to let go of what people think. Secondly, cultivate self-compassion. self-compassion, let go of perfectionism. What self-compassion? Lack of self-compassion will not allow you to receive love. You feel you have to qualify for everything. Some people are effective, they love to do things well, but for some other people, it's lack of self-compassion that wants to make you kill yourself to achieve perfection. Perfection. Perfection is good, but if it's because you feel you have to do something to gain people's respect or, you know, things like that, then it becomes something else. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying this afternoon. The ability to cultivate self-compassion, let go of perfectionism, because it stops you from receiving love. You always feel you have to qualify. Cultivate a resilient spirit. Let go of numbness and powerlessness. Cultivate a resilient spirit. You see, when a man has a resilient spirit, even at the provocation of your wife, you won't throw that punch. The resilient spirit will bring something deep in your heart that can make you just walk away. Maybe take your car and just drive off. Just go and take fresh breeze and come back home. That's a resilient spirit. Somebody needs to cultivate that. All this numbness and powerlessness, don't provoke me. You understand what I'm saying? It provoked me, or she provoked me. I didn't know what to do again. Because you ask, where did you get black eye from? It's my husband. What happened? Bros, when you are not Ogambasi or Mike Tyson, what's happening here? And truly, if you want to fight, you go to the stadium and meet your colleagues. Let's know if you survive that real one. This one of flexing muscle at home with somebody that cannot fight you. You know, so without any apologies to men, some men truly should go to Moto Park if they want to fight. Truly, where you have Amugbo boys and demonstrate that you have muscle, not at home. As in, if the devil really wants to move you to fight, tell him, move me to the Moto Park. You know, in Nigeria, Moto Park is a place where you have the real boys. Yes. And then try your luck there. Let's see how it pans out. But this one that you want to turn your living room into a boxing arena, cultivate resilience. Go and, just go and get fresh air somewhere and tell God, thank you for grace. If not for grace, you know. I mean, look at what happened when Abigail met David. I'm sure David would have been saying, God, why did you allow this woman to come? I would have shown this man my capacity. See men, see something. They will trample over everything. That party will be torn to shreds. Then you will know that there's a man in Israel that has strong men. The Bible described the men of David. They were warriors. These guys went out on a snowy day and killed a bear with bare hand. Those are the men that were following David. And then one guy, he said, give us jollof rice, and you're making noise. What's the meaning of that? I hope you understand what I'm saying. Yeah. And David was like, what kind of human being is this? Don't you know who he's talking? It's time to cultivate a resilient spirit. Let go of numbness and powerlessness. When you feel that powerlessness, call for grace. The strength of God starts from when my strength stops. I hope you understand what I'm saying. That's the resilient spirit that we're talking about. When I cannot take what my husband is doing again, grace can come upon me to take it in a new way. And I will still walk in love. Whatever grieves the heart of God will not come from me. Because I made a decision to love. Like I said 2 Sundays ago, love is not just an emotion, it's a decision. I've made a decision to love. It's when it becomes a decision that the emotional part makes sense. Cultivate gratitude and joy. Let go of gloominess and heaviness of heart. The truth is that heaviness of heart will not allow love to stay. It's difficult to love someone who is gloomy, who is always heavy. Cultivate intuition and trust in faith. Let go of the need for physical certainty. We have to trust. I've been hurt before. I can't get into a relationship. Get in and trust God. Get in and trust God. Get in and trust God. Let go of the need for physical certainty. Cultivate creativity. Let go of crippling comparisons. They that compare themselves with themselves and compare themselves among themselves, the Bible says they are not wise. Don't compare your relationship with another person's relationship. Don't let people get you to compare you with another person. When you lead a unit at work, the people there will compare you with the person that left before you. The person that vacated the seat for you. Say it's nicer than you. Is this, is that. You know, all those kind of things. But when you focus on creativity and you tell yourself, I want to be myself, I want to do things better, I want to just evolve, I want to do what I'm supposed to do. Cultivate play and rest. Let go of exhaustion as a status symbol and productivity as self-worth. The way some people are carrying themselves, people who are making 10 times the amount of money you make, they still smile, they still play with their spouse and their children. But your own is exhaustion all the time. You can't even say you love yourself, let alone love me another person. I remember one time I had to tell my wife that even Obama, President of America, they still show him on, at least you still see him going on holiday with his family. If Obama can go on holiday, there's no reason for anybody not to go on holiday. I don't think there's any country that's volatile as America and, you know, with issues everywhere. So cultivate play and rest. Let go of exhaustion as a status symbol. That we are the hustlers of Lagos. Always working, never stopping. We don't have time to love anybody. We don't have time to even love ourselves. There's nothing in that. Cultivate calm and stillness. Let go of anxiety as a lifestyle. Cultivate laughter, song, and dance. Let go of being cool and always in control. David demonstrated that when they brought the Ark of Covenant. That's where we got the song from. How we dance, how we dance, how we dance.